Dearly beloved, it is always a pleasure. It's always so good to come your way with the surest word broadcast. My name is Patrick M. Hagan, and as usual, I'm the one who created the surest word on all social media platforms. And we have been looking at a topic that is so dear to my heart, and I decided to do some research into it, combining the Bible and other literature to change a certain narrative that is going on with the war that is on between great leaders of vision and smart proteges with ideas. But in doing this, we are looking at leadership and followership and what this subject means to the world. As a matter of fact, when we get to a point, you would understand that this world cannot move on without great leaders. In the same vein, the world cannot move on with smart proteges. We need a two to harmonize for this world to become a better place. And so in the last broadcast, we looked at leading without oppressing. Leading without oppressing. And today, I'm going to continue with the same teaching on leading without oppressing. But I'll be looking at something else. So our foundational scripture is the same. We're using the same scripture that we used in our last broadcast, 1 Samuel 12:3. So quickly, I want to read the foundational scripture to you, and I'm always using the Amplified Bible version. And so 1 Samuel 12:3 says that, "Here I am, testify against me before the Lord, and Saul his anointed, whose ox or donkey have I taken? Or whom have I defrauded or oppressed? Or from whose hand have I received any bribe to blind my eyes? Tell me, and I will restore it to you." The other foundational scripture that we use was taken from Ruth chapter 2 and verse 4. And I'm reading again from the Amplified Version. It says that, "And behold, Boaz, the master, came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, that is workers, servants, or the followers, 'The Lord be with you.' And they answered him, 'The Lord bless you.'" And so the other time, the other broadcast, we looked at the reasons why some people would want to lead their people using oppressive means. And we saw that people come from religious lines to lead their people through oppressive means. Our world has seen a lot of religion that has oppressed people and use it to brutalize all kinds of people. We also saw that people use racial discrimination even to brutalize people. And we also considered philosophical ideology that some leaders would have to use. And last one, not the least, we also looked at democratic dictatorship, what is currently in vogue in our world. Then we looked at the cost of authoritarian leadership in the world history, and we looked at the rule of the cruelest leaders in world history. And I mentioned leaders like Pharaoh Necho II. I mentioned Nebuchadnezzar II. We also talked a little bit. I mentioned Pol Pot, the rule of Joseph Stalin, Adolf Hitler, and all these people. Today, we want to shift our attention from what we did the last time, and now look at the effective way of leading without being despotic. The effective way of leading without being despotic. And so the first thing that I need you to understand as a leader is that you must always know and remember that you are not indispensable. Every leader must understand this, that as a leader, you are not dispensable. And now I get it, because there is all kinds of philosophy that are moving around. And when you read books on leadership and power, people learn all manner of things. And one of the things that people learn is that there is this philosophy that suggests that learn to make people dependent on you. So in trying to make people dependent on you, you create a kind of aura, a kind of environment, a kind of atmosphere that suggests that you are going to live forever. However, when you checkmate this philosophy with the Bible, it makes this philosophy falls flat. Because you see, that kind of philosophy brings about a certain kind of thinking. So there is a certain kind of thinking behind indispensability. And one of the thinking is that it creates a sense of immortality. It creates a sense of immortality. And you know, the sense of immortality suggests that you, the leader who is a human being, will not die. But very soon we will check it from the Bible and to see whether a human being, it doesn't matter the power that you wield, whether you will not die. The other thing that it creates is that it creates a sense of omniscience. It makes you the leader be that you know everything, like a kind of you assuming the state of God, that the leader, I mean, knows everything. But we know that every human being is limited. You cannot be like God. As a matter of fact, the fact that even we Christians, the Bible says that we have the mind of God. Now, the fact that we have the mind of God does not mean that we can take the place of God. And so when you read Psalm 89, verse 48, the Bible says, and I want to quote it to you. It says that, "What man is he that liveth and shall not see death?" So that makes the sense of immortality falls flat. That one makes the sense of immortality in indispensability. It falls flat. What man is he that liveth? Even Methuselah, who lived around 900 and something years, he had to die. Everybody dies. Just recently, we have seen in world history that the Queen of England is dead. No matter the power that she wielded for over 76 years or so, she had to die. We have seen all kinds of leaders who have come and gone, they will die. And so you must know, and it must get to you. And let me finish reading this Bible. It says, "Shall he deliver his soul from the grave?" There is no leader who can deliver himself from the grave. Indeed, the only one person who was able to deliver himself from the grave is the Lord Jesus Christ. He died, and within 3 days, he had to rise up. Apart from Jesus, there is no other leader. Yes, other leaders, other people were raptured like Elijah. Okay, so that one is different. I mean, we have people like Amos. The Bible says that Amos walked with God. I mean, he was taken. And so, I mean, these are exceptional cases. But apart from that, all leaders would have to die at a point. And so you cannot assume a state where you become everything, that your people will see you that you are indispensable. You are. We can dispense every human being. Every human being has limitations. And so you as a leader must know that there is a danger for you to think that without you, nobody can do the job. And unfortunately, most people around the world and leaders around the world sometimes think that without them, the job cannot be done. Let me assure you, may you drop dead now. Or should you drop dead now, the job will continue. Our world has come far. Because when one baton leaves your hand and is passed on to the other people who are leaving are able to use it and carry on. Now, the other thinking of behind the issue of indispensability is the creation of personality cults. The issue of personality cults that we form around leaders. Because if you think that you are indispensable and you show to your world that your followers that you are indispensable, then they see you as a thank God. And unfortunately, in the world, a lot of people have positioned themselves like that. And many people are being worshipped. They are taking the place of God. If you lead like that, you cannot be effective. And so when you read about a certain man called William Branham in the USA was a founder of the spoken word. He was a powerful man of God. Actually, a brief study that I did about William Branham suggests that. I mean, he was not literate. He was not a literate person. But the power of God came upon William Branham, saying that he was able to do a lot of healing. He was healing. He had a healing anointing and was healing. But at a point in his ministry, he started going into what we call classical theology. And in doing classical theology, he started deviating. And he had built a kind of a followership to the extent that his people believed that when he dies, he was going to, be raised. And so it is said that the man died on 24th December 1965. But his body was kept till Easter in 1966, when they realized that he was indeed not going to rise up again. This was a powerful man of God, leading people. But he led them, said that the people had put their trust in him. They had put their belief in him, building personality cult in him. But you remember in Jeremiah 17 and verse 5, and I read to you, the Bible says that, "Thus said the Lord, cursed be the man or the follower that trusted in man or in his leader, and maketh flesh arm, and whose heart departed from the Lord. Cursed is any man who puts his trust in man." So as a leader, you do not want to position yourself to your followers as though you are indispensable. The other thing that you are, as a leader, you need to know is that you need to consider your followers as your assignment and not your asset. Consider your followers as your assignment and not your asset. And here, if you have a certain background in finance, you would know that our asset, credit, our cash flow. Assets are very important to us. And because they credit our cash flow, we become so possessive with them. And so in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 21, the Bible says that our hearts are where our treasure is. And so wherever the person's assets are, the heart of the person is there. And so the person becomes so possessive. I mean, where your money is, your mind will be following it. Where your assets are, your mind will be following it. So you become so possessive. The other thing that assets we do to assets is that we bequeath assets to family members. When we die, when I die and I have an asset or I have assets, it will be bequeathed to my family members or people who are very close to me. And so you must get it that when people are following you, you need to be careful. You need to be careful. Now, our assignments makes us servants. Every leader is a servant. And we are servant to the one that called us. We are servant and accountable to God, who has given us the mandate to be able to lead. Our assignment on earth are not transferable. That is the other thing that you need to know as a leader. God has peculiar assignment for everybody. So even when you look at a situation where God told Elijah, go and transfer your ministry to Elisha. When Elijah transferred his ministry to Elisha didn't do exactly the same thing that Elijah did. So the assignment of Elijah was different from the assignment of Elisha. It is said that Elijah performed 16 miracles, but Elisha did 32. They had different assignment. We have a situation where God would tell David, among your children, appoint Solomon to be king. Now, you need to remember that though David transferred the kingship of Israel to Solomon, yet David was more seen as a man of war, than Solomon, who ruled for 40 years, being a man of peace. The same kingdom. But one was a man of war, the other was a man of peace. We can talk about Moses and Joshua. Moses transferred, the leadership mantle to Joshua. Yet Moses was more of a priest and a prophet than Joshua, who was seen as a military man. And so really, our assignment on earth cannot be transferred. And therefore, when you are leading your people, you must always remember that they are your assignment. You come into the lives of people for a time to do specific things. They are not your asset. So stop being possessive of your followers. It doesn't mean that as a leader, you have to be careless of your followers. But don't be crazy. Don't be crazy. Say that you possess them. Don't be crazy. Say that you would oppress them. You have to lead them through the dictates and the direction that God gives unto you as you lead them. Now, the other thing that you have to know as a leader, anytime you are leading people, is that you need to always listen to your heart before you rely on your mind. Listen to your heart in decision making before you rely on your mind. In this, you have to know that leadership is an art that takes a lot of skill to do it. In leadership, you have to, combine all kinds of skills to be able to do it. And if you are going to always rely on your mind, and that is what I've seen, studies have proven that most of the despotic leaders that the world has ever seen always relied on their minds instead of considering their heart. And so when you consider somebody like David, the relationship between David and Saul, King Saul, you remember that David, when he had killed Goliath, had made enemy for himself. He had been anointed to be king, killed Goliath. And so Saul, his master, realized that, hey, this young man wanted to take his throne from him. And out there, when David was in the wilderness, Saul was always looking for a chance or a point to kill David. And David had a clear opportunity to be able to take the life of Saul. But let's listen to what David did in the Bible. In 1 Samuel 24, verse 4 to 5, the Bible says that, and I want to read a portion. The Bible says that, "And the men of David said unto him, Behold, the day of which the Lord said unto thee, Behold, I will deliver thy enemy." And you see here that the thy enemy, they are considering the enemy to be Saul, "into thy hand, that thou mayest do to him as it shall seem good unto thee." Now let's see what David did. "Then David arose and cut off the skirt of Saul's robe privately. And it came to pass afterward that David's heart smote him." I want you to take note of that. "And it came to pass that David's heart smote him because he had cut off Saul's skirt." 1 Samuel 24, 4 to 5. So really, in the mind of David, he wanted to kill Saul. In the mind of David. But you see, every great leader, you must know that we don't lead people by using the mind always. Yes, we make all decisions in the mind, but you have to allow your heart, what God is telling your heart, every leader. Because if you don't allow the things that come out in your heart to help you lead, and you are going to always rely on your mind, your mind is going to play tricks on you. Indeed, it has been said that when you become so successful, always your mind plays tricks on you. So you check leaders. At a time that leaders are looking for positions in our various democratic election, they become very apologetic. They come and beg us that we should vote for them. The moment we vote for them and they become our leaders, let's now listen to how they speak back to us. They speak to us with impunity, and some would go to the extent of insulting the intelligence of their followers. It's all because at that height, they allow their mind to be detected. When they are looking for the votes, it is their heart. It is their heart. So wherever you are listening to me in the world, you can check across the length and breadth of the world. Various presidents, various leaders, when they are looking for the power, they beg the electorate that give me the power. Once they get the power, they become so power drunk and the mind start playing tricks on them. And so you as a leader can be effective when you rely more on your heart. Let the heart speak to you. Because the Bible says that out of the heart are all the issues of life. It didn't say out of the mind. Out of the heart, they are all the issues of life. The other thing that you need to know is that you need to know that your followers, without your followers, they are no leaders. This one is so simple. Without followers, they are no leaders. And you should understand and know that the day followers will stop following leaders, there can't be any leader. This must sink into our mind. And so when you go into the cocoa industry, the chocolate industry, a company like Cadbury, that is in England, uses about 70% of its cocoa coming from Ghana. And it has been said that in 2020, the cocoa industry was to the tune of almost about $208.15 billion. $208.15 billion. Yet out of this money, a paltry amount of about 6% was given to Africa, the whole continent of Africa. And you know that in the whole continent of Africa, Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire alone produces about 2/3 of the cocoa in the world. Yet this amount of $208.15 billion, a paltry 6%, that is an amount of about $6.24 billion, came to Africa. Not Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, the whole of Africa. So can you imagine that the day Africa will decide that we want to process our own cocoa, how can Cadbury in England lead? How can those who are making the billions out of the sweat of the farmers in Africa get their billions in cocoa and the chocolate industry? So when you are a leader, you must know and understand that without followers, your leadership is nothing. And therefore, when you are leading people, you need to really respect them. Give them some level of respect and lead them very well. The other thing that a leader can do to be able to lead effectively is to consider your today's followers into your tomorrow's leadership. We don't lead only for today, we lead for tomorrow. And you must understand that the proper account of your leadership is better done by people who never even experience your leadership. Yes, usually when you are leading, there will be sycophants, people around you who will be singing your praises. Those who are saying all kinds of nice things about you, that, oh, you are doing well. Yes, it is good to some extent. But if we want a true account of your leadership, the impact, the real impact of your leadership, it is often done by people who never experience your leadership. And I can give a typical example. When Jesus Christ was on earth, his ministry was said that Peter, who later became the leader of the Christian community or of the apostles, had told Jesus that he was the Christ. giving a testimony, a firm testimony about the leadership of Jesus Christ. That was so good. It was so good. But then there came a time when Jesus was on the cross. Another person, a military person, who had nothing to do with Jesus, had not benefited from Jesus in any way. In the case of Peter, he had benefited somehow from Jesus. He had seen some miracles. Indeed, his own mother-in-law was healed out of a fever. He had eaten from the miracles of Jesus. But this man, the military man. But indeed, when Jesus was on the cross, that man was able to give a sterling testimony. He said that indeed this man was the Son of God. That is a true testimony. So our leadership is often not, the true leadership is not often, the account is not given by people who, enjoy our leadership in the present. And Paul said something to the people of Philippi. He says that wherefore, in Philippians 2 and verse 12, he says that wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. The two words are being used there, presence and absence. When the leader is present, yes, you need to obey. But when he is absent, when he is not there, when his period of leadership has expired, that is where the impact is more. And therefore, as a leader, you need to know that. The other thing that you, the leader, must know is that every time, before you take any decision, you need to flip the coin more than once before you act. Flip the coin more than once. So you need to understand that leadership and followership game is a game of probability. Today, one is a leader. Another is a follower. Tomorrow, the leader can become a follower. You need to understand that. If you are a leader today, you will not forever become a leader. So when we come to parenting, for instance, and I see parents, fathers, mothers, who brutalize their children, beat them, as though they are their colleagues. They forget that one day, this child that you are beating, you are abusing, you are molesting, this child will grow and will have power over you. So you must always flip the coin more than once. Use the principle of the game of probability. When you flip the coin, it will either give you a head or a tail. Flip it again. You will not always get a head. It might be that a tail will come. That is how leaders, we must see and lead. So when we are leading people, you must always look at them from that angle. So that if you oppress them today, tomorrow, a follower may also assume the reins of power. And that follower may also pay you back. But I pray that as we are going through this teaching, you are learning. And as a leader, you are not going to lead by being oppressive. Lastly, I want you to know that from Leviticus chapter 25, verse 43, the Bible says something to leaders. And I want leaders to listen to this. The Bible says, and it's an amplified version I'm reading to you, you, the leader, shall not rule or lead over him, that is the follower, with harshness, that is with severity or with oppression, but you, the leader, shall fear your God. I want to repeat the scripture, Leviticus chapter 25 and verse 43, amplified version. You, the leader, shall, and it is a shall, it is mandatory, it is not me, it is mandatory. Shall not rule, shall not lead over him, the follower, with harshness. That is with severity, with abuse, and with oppression. But you, the leader, shall fear your God. And if you fear your God, you will lead people very well. And so as we have come to the end of this broadcast, I want you to know that there is a man whose name is called Jesus. That man is the perfect leader who shows us how to lead and how to follow. At one point, he was giving instruction to his followers. At another point, he was washing their feet. He was showing them how to lead and how to follow. There is a kind of synergy that we can apply as leaders and as followers. So give your life to Jesus if you have not given your life to Jesus. The Bible says that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, to the world that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. John 1 verse 12. So I want you to give your life to Jesus. He loves you so much, and that he came to die for you. Thank you so much for staying on and for listening to this broadcast. You can like our page and you can share it with people. The next time when I come your way, we are going to be looking at the topic, leading men with a rectitude heart. Leading men with a rectitude heart. May God bless you. Shalom.